Amen. You may be seated, friends. We want to welcome you to Stillwater Church today. My name is John. I'm one of the pastors here. We are so glad that you joined us. I mean, it would have been so lonely if it were just me and the band here, and I'm so glad you all came out. And we especially want to welcome those who are joining us on Facebook Live as well. In fact, we kind of owe you one, because the folks on Facebook Live has really done us all a favor this morning, because if it weren't for them staying home and watching, there would have been absolutely no seats in here. I mean, it is so packed, you wouldn't even believe. If they weren't laughing, you might find this more believable, right? But no, seriously, while we may be a little lighter today than usual, it's all good, because the Spirit of God is absolutely here. And we're here to worship Jesus. And he says we're two or more gathered, right? And we've blown that number away by a long shot. So I am so glad just to get to worship Jesus here with you. We're continuing our message series where we're looking at the five key statements that define our vision here at Stillwater. And the statement that we're looking at today is the one that says, saved people serve people. Saved people serve people. It means that once we find Jesus, or I should say once Jesus finds us, that it's not a matter that it's all done then and we just kind of wait to die and go to heaven someday. No, it's about living for Jesus here on this earth. It's about serving others. About how God can use us to make an impact here in this world all around us. God wants to do that in your life, in my life, in our life together as a church. Serving is so important to who we are. It's part of our key DNA here at Stillwater. And you know, there's a lot of maybe enemies to serving or reasons why folks can't serve, but I think probably we all know the number one reason is busyness, right? We've all got a lot of stuff going on. It's part of living in America in 2019. We're all quite busy, or at least we feel quite busy a lot of the time, and I get that. But you know, it's easy sometimes to fill our lives up with all sorts of stuff that doesn't really matter and miss out on the things that are most centrally important in life. This weekend, we've got many examples of serving. I'm humbled by folks who come out early this morning to shovel snow, to set out food, to have a great worship set ready to go, to take care of our children, all these other things. This happens every weekend at Stillwater, but especially on a crazy day like today, I'm just so thankful for that. One example I would highlight of serving this weekend is that on Friday evening, we found out that the person who was going to be singing the soprano part wasn't able to do so this weekend. And so we texted Sarah and said, hey, we need somebody to sing. And of course, at this point, the Saturday night service was like less than 24 hours away, right? So we needed somebody to sing like right away. And you might say, oh, well, Sarah was probably able to do that on such short notice because she's probably not a real busy person, right? But you would be wrong in saying so, because you may not know that Sarah actually is a mom to triplets, then two other kids at home, right? And that alone, I mean, we have three kids, but I can't imagine triplets, right? Like, that's just, I have mad respect for anybody who can do that. And so on top of that, Sarah's here singing. Now, although I must say, we did find a kind of a resource that showed us what Sarah's bedtime prayer looked like this weekend. It was this, you know, busy mom's prayer, right? And many of us know this prayer, right? Whether you're a busy mom or busy somebody else, you know what it's like to feel that way, where you just don't have any energy left. Or maybe others of us, we feel very busy all the time, but this other next cartoon is kind of helpful. That, you know, we're super busy. We're like, oh, if I had time, I'd do all these awesome things. But then when we have time, sometimes we kind of squander it a little bit, don't we? And if that's you, please don't feel bad. We all do this from time to time. And look, we need rest. We need boundaries. We need these things in our lives. These are really, really important things. But we also need to be serving, because God calls us to serve. He uses us when we serve. And he changes the world through us when we do so. There, over 2,400 years ago, Socrates said this: beware of the barrenness of a busy life. The barrenness of a busy life. And he was saying this before he had, you know, smartphones that could fill our minds with all sorts of information all the time, right? He knew what it was like, that you can fill up your life with so many things that are good things, that are things that keep you busy, but they don't fill you. They don't give you meaning. They don't give you purpose. They don't give you a drive for the stuff that really matters here in this life. So why would we want to prioritize serving? In the midst of all the other things we could be doing, why would we want to prioritize serving here in this world? Well, we've got the ultimate example, who's Jesus, and Jesus taught us some things about what serving is. And so today we're going to look at four of those that come from the book of Philippians, chapter 2. And this passage is one of the central passages in the Bible that describes who Jesus is. Okay, verse 5. It says thus, that we must have the same attitude that Christ Jesus had. Though he was God, he did not think of equality with God as something to cling to. Instead, he gave up his divine privileges, he took the humble position of a slave, and was born as a human being. When he appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God, and he died a criminal's death on the cross. Therefore, God elevated him to the place of highest honor and gave him the name that is above all other names, that at the name of Jesus Christ, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and underneath the earth, and every tongue should declare that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. So the Bible's talking, it tells us about Jesus, how he left heaven. He's God, right? And he comes down from heaven to this earth. That's a very humbling thing, to leave the beauty of heaven and to come down here and to do life with us. But not only that, he didn't just come here to this earth. He surrendered himself to death, even death on a cross. Roman capital punishment that Jesus had done nothing to deserve. This is the place that he came to. He went from the highest of heights to the lowest of lows. Why? Because he loves you. Because he loves me. Because that's how much we matter to God. This is an incredibly high standard that the book of Philippians sets for us here. This passage, for me, it kind of both inspires me and it scares me a little bit. It's inspirational when I think of the incredible love of God that he would do that. It reminds me of just how valuable my life is and your life is. And that's inspirational. But it's a little bit scary, too, because it's saying that our attitude should be the same as Christ Jesus, that we should have that same humble spirit. And that is a really, really high standard, don't you think? I mean, I wish he would have said, your attitude should be kind of like Jesus, but down a few notches, right? Because who can be that great, right? But he says, no, your attitude should be the same as Jesus Christ. And we'll explain more about what that means. But you think about what a high standard that is. It may feel like such a gap between where we are and where Jesus is. I remember growing up, my sister learned to play the clarinet. Have any clarinet players here with us today? A couple, yeah, we got a couple today, yep. And I remember, I don't know how it was for you, but I remember what it was like when she started out. Particularly, I remember her very first band concert. And I remember going and sitting through this thing and listening, and let me tell you, this concert was terrible. It was painful, all the instruments were squeaking, the bass drum was way off beat, right? I'm not a musician, and so I could be an armchair one here, right, and criticize people who are doing things I don't know how to do. And let me tell you, it was not good news. And imagine if after that concert, they would have taken that band of little kids and they played for them some Beethoven, right? And they're like, your attitude should be like Beethoven's, right? Like, oh my gosh, that's a pretty high standard, right? Thank God that it's a journey of grace that we're on. None of us are there yet, but yet we're all called to continue growing in that grace, growing to be more and more like Jesus. And as we continue to surrender more and more of ourselves to Jesus, we find that he changes our hearts, our minds, our attitudes, and our actions to look more and more like Jesus. That's the path, really, to greatness in this world. Jesus said that if you want to be great in the kingdom of God, you must be the servant of all. He didn't just say this, he lived it. So let's look at a few examples, or a few things that we learned from Jesus out of this. The first thing that serving is that serving is giving up my rights for the rights of others. That's what serving is all about, giving up my rights for the rights of others. Now this is not something that we often love to do, right? We prefer to keep our own rights. We don't like to give them up. In fact, if you've ever worked in food service or customer service, you've probably heard this little phrase that goes, the customer is always right, right? It's what people say when they're being a real jerk to the wait staff, usually, right? Like, I'm right because I have the dollars, and so you got to do what I want you to do. We don't like to give up our rights. We like to kind of wave them around. Like, hey, everybody should be what I want them to be because I've got rights here. And sometimes we bring that mentality everywhere we go. We could even bring it to church, right? We could even do this, right? You know, the volume of the music needs to be exactly like I want it to be, right? Or the coffee needs to be exactly how I would prefer it. Or maybe during church this summer we could start a new ministry where somebody would wash my car while I attend church. That would be great, right? I'd love that kind of church. Because we take this consumer mentality in, but it's really kind of backwards when you think about it, because the church is not the pastor, it's not the staff, it's all of us really together. It is. We are all the church. We're all Christ's body here, and each of us have such an important part to play as we serve. You know, in life you've got authority, right? And you have positional authority, and you have actual authority. And these can be two different things. And when we are clinging on to our rights, we're trying to cling on to some type of perceived positional authority. But that's not really what it's all about. I remember in high school, I was a junior in high school. I was taking Algebra 2. I waited until my junior year because this will probably shock you, but I did not take advanced math, right? I know. You're like, surely he would have. No, I didn't, right? Like, I know. And so I was in Algebra 2, and we had a brand new teacher. He had just graduated from college, brand new to teaching, and quite frankly, he was not a very effective teacher. In fact, he would be fired before Christmas that year. It didn't go well for him. There were two main things that he struggled with that were kind of central. Well, first, this wasn't one of the struggles, but he was really kind of a goofy-looking guy, right? In fact, I'm not really exaggerating much here. The closest thing I know to how he looked was Napoleon Dynamite. Like that, it was very, very, very close. I wish I had a picture to show you just how close it was. But the big struggles he had was, first, he did not understand math very well, which is a real drawback when you're an Algebra 2 teacher, right? Like, he would do problems on the board, and he would get them wrong, and students would have to correct them. So that was a factor. But the second one, and maybe even bigger, was that he didn't understand how to control a class of high schoolers. Oftentimes, he would come to class late. We'd be in there sitting and talking, as high schoolers typically would. And he would, you know, stand up in front of the class, and of course, we would not stop talking, as typical high school students, right? And so he would stand up there, and in a monotone voice, he would address the class exactly like this. He would say, "Class, please be quiet. Class, you're still talking. Class, I don't understand why you're talking. Class, is anyone listening right now? Class, hello? Hello? Hello?" And that would go on sometimes for about 2 minutes, no exaggeration. And eventually, due to no impact of his constant talking, we'd still be talking, and so he'd be frustrated, and he would finally raise his voice, and he would say, "Class, I am the teacher." And if you have to remind people that you are the teacher, right, you've kind of lost the game already, don't you think? That's this positional authority, saying, these are my rights, this is who I am, thus this is how it should be. And if anybody had the right to come to this earth and pull the positional authority card, would have been Jesus. I am God. I was right there at creation, right? So if anybody should be able to be served here on this earth, it's me, right? Because I'm God. You're not God. But that was not Jesus' approach. Not at all. Jesus took on the form of a servant, right? He was a servant leader. A leader who led with great humility. Reminds me of another example. A few years ago, I got to go to Tijuana with some folks from Stillwater, to Tijuana Christian Mission, a mission we supported for a long time. In fact, I think we're going back there this year. I know Pastor Brady is working with some others on a trip. We'll keep you posted. It'll be really exciting. We've raised last year over $20,000 between us and a few other churches, and to put together a trip. There'll be multiple phases, multiple churches doing a lot of work. It's going to be great. And a few years ago, when we were doing something like that, I was there in our phase. It fit my skill set perfectly. We were in the demolition phase, right? You get to break stuff, and it was so much fun. And I remember that we were tearing out this one large room there at the mission. And this was a two-story building. And kind of central in this room, there were these two big columns. And the guy who was the maintenance guy there was kind of our overseer. And he said, hey, those columns, they're always in the way. Let's just take them out, right? Let's take them down. And so we had a couple of guys with sledgehammers excited and ready to take these things down. But when he said that, I looked over at a guy named Dave in our group. Dave is a professional in this kind of stuff, building-related stuff. And I saw Dave's eyebrows go up when he said we should take out these pillars. And I just saw Dave kind of pulled the guy aside, and he took him upstairs, and he showed him how on top of those pillars on the second floor were other pillars, right? And those pillars went up to the roof, right? So you can imagine if you take those columns out that, well, the roof is going to fall in, right? Which would not have been the outcome they were looking for, even though we were the demolition crew. And so the thing that was so impressive to me was Dave could have easily pulled rank. He could have easily said, oh, no, 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 no. You don't know what you're talking about. I'm a professional here. You're going to knock the whole place down. I can't believe you'd even say that. But he didn't. He did so with great humility and with kindness and with a quiet spirit. I think he had that attitude that Jesus would have had. So first, we give up our rights for others. Second, we become less so that others can become more. We become less so that others can become more. Verse 7, instead, Jesus gave up his divine privileges. He took the humble position of a slave and was born as a human being. Now, this is really, really tough, to become less so that others can become more. Because for many of us, we're so busy, we're climbing ladders, and it doesn't matter if we step on other people below us or whatever. It just is what it is. Where Jesus is saying that we're to become less so that others can become more. And this was not just a theory for Jesus. This was a way of living. Remember the Last Supper, right? How he took the towel and the basin, and he went around, he washed his disciples' feet. I read that it would have been the job of the lowest-ranking person to be the foot washer, right? If there was maybe a servant there or a helper or something like that. But since there was not, it would have been appropriate for maybe the lowest ranking disciple to do that. Not sure who that was. I would have voted Judas personally, but I don't know. Surely somebody, right? But yet none of them doesn't. None of them picks up the towel and the basin to go wash feet. Instead, Jesus does. And you remember Peter's response. Peter says, oh, no, no, Lord, you can't be doing this, right? We know who you are, and yet Jesus insists, if I don't wash you, you don't have any part in me, Peter. This is how central serving is to Jesus. He sets the example for us, not just then, but on countless occasions, of how he is God, the one who could pull rank at any time, and yet he serves. He serves. He set the ultimate example. If Jesus will serve, why wouldn't you and I? I mean, if the God of creation will come and will serve, surely you and I can too. And you know, I think there's something beautiful in this, because sometimes the reason we don't serve is because we don't feel confident. Say, I don't have it all together, right? Like, I don't know what this person knows, or I can't do what that person does, or sing like this person, or whatever it may be. But it's not about that. God works through our limits, through our limitations, and as we live humble lives, lives that are honest about our limitations, God works through us in powerful ways. You don't think you can do everything, and you're right, you can't. We need one another. Pastor Irwin McManus says this, you can't solve the whole problem, but the whole problem cannot be solved without you. I like that. I think there's some truth in that. Or maybe a tweak would be to say that there will be some problems that won't be solved if we don't surrender ourselves to God and allow God to work through us. You know, I know that God wants to do so much through us, and yet he chooses us. I mean, he's God. He's got angels. He's got options. He's the creator of the universe. He can do whatever he wants, and yet he chooses to use us. And I think that means that I deeply need to serve. It's not just that God can't, like, figure it out on his own. He can. He's all-powerful. But yet I, in my spirit, in myself, I need to serve. You need to serve. Because that's who God has called us to be. It's the type of people God has called us to be. Number 3, serving is being obedient, even when it is expensive, even when it costs us. If anyone would know this, it would be Jesus. Verse 8, when Jesus appeared in human form, he humbled himself in obedience to God and died a criminal's death on the cross. You know, there's nothing that God would ever call you to do that even comes close to what he gave up for us. The God of creation gives his life like a criminal for a crime that he didn't commit. I'm the one who committed the crime. I'm the sinner. I'm the one who deserved to die, and yet Jesus became obedient, even though it was so, so expensive. You know, sometimes we take kind of an opposite position, and we say, you know, I want to do the things that I like to do, right? And so I may not be serving, but that's because, you know, I got other stuff to do, and it's just, you know, that's just not a priority in my life or in my schedule right now. And there's kind of two sides to this. On the one hand, we want you to serve in areas where you're well-equipped. In fact, soon we'll teach a class called Soar With Your Strengths. It's a great class, a great way to learn how God has wired you and how you can serve him most effectively. We invite you to take that soon. But and we want you to serve in your area of strength. For example, that's why I do not sing on the praise team, right? Because if I did, you would know instantly why I don't sing on the praise team. I just do not have any musical abilities whatsoever. But we can take that too far. We could take it to the extreme of saying, you know, I feel like that the gift of God in my life is that I'm called to serve on that team that, like, eats nachos and watches football. Like, it's right in the middle of my skill set, right? I would be outstanding at that. Yeah, you know, sometimes serving costs. So it costs time. Costs energy. It causes sacrifices in our lives that we might not otherwise make. And that's not only okay, that's a good thing. It's a good thing. We cannot get out of the starting blocks of faith if we're not willing to serve. We just can't do it. We need to be willing to serve others. Fourth, serving is a temporary sacrifice for a future reward. A temporary, short-term, maybe sometimes longer than others, but it's a temporary sacrifice for a future reward, because ultimately, this life here on earth is temporary. It comes to an end for every single one of us. I hope that for me and for you, that's a long, long, long time away. Fact is, I don't know how long it is for me, but I know that when we make sacrifices here on earth, that God rewards that. Philippians chapter 2, verse 9, therefore, God elevated Jesus to the place of highest honor and gave him the name that is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue can declare that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. God elevated Jesus. Here he came, he left heaven, he comes down to the lowest possible place, and yet God elevates him because of who he is, because of how he gave his life for us. So for us, as we serve, I really think that when we make sacrifices, that God honors that in a different but important kind of way. You know, the Bible talks about how in heaven someday we cast our crowns before Jesus, right? Whatever these rewards are, that we use these to worship God. That I believe that God rewards us both now and in eternity for the acts of service that we do. I think it's such a meaningful thing to do. And I'm so honored to be part of a church where serving is so important. Whether you teach a class or a small group, whether you serve on our prayer team, whether you shovel snow on cold mornings, you set out food so that others can feel welcome here, whether you teach a confirmation class to our teens, you change diapers in the nursery, you fix stuff around the building, you serve on the board and give leadership, whether you are there for our children, for our kids with special needs, whether you build a house out in the parking lot on a warmer day than this, whatever it is that you do, thank you. God is working through you. God is working through you in bigger ways than you or I know. God is doing so much. You know, we serve an unlimited God who gives so many good gifts to us, and he invites us to give those back through serving, through generosity, through so many things. I like what St. Teresa said. She said this: Christ has no body but yours. No hands, no feet here on earth but yours. It's through your eyes that Christ looks at the world with compassion. yours are the feet with which Christ walks to do good in the world. It is with your hands that Christ blesses the world. I think there's truth in that. You know, Jesus, he ascended into heaven, right? And he entrusted his mission there to 11 disciples and some other followers. And if you look at the lives of those disciples up to that point, their resumes were often very flawed, very messed up. They were as messed up as probably you and I. And yet God used them to change the world. We sit here today because God spread his good news by the power of his Holy Spirit through willing and faithful servants. And he's still doing that today. He's spreading his good news through the hands, the feet, the voices, the kindness, the love, the generosity of willing and faithful servants. So that's why we serve. Because we need to in our spirit, and because when we do, God does things. And my prayer continually for our church is that we would be a place where that when folks see the ministries that happen at Stillwater, that they would say, God must be at work. Because I know those people, and this is much greater than those people. This is truly the work of God in their midst. Would you pray with me? Here we are, Lord. Take our lives. Use us. Use us for your glory. God, as we serve, I pray that you would change the world through us. That your Holy Spirit would be doing miracles, things that we could never do on our own, God. That you would do a great and mighty work here and in Dayton, in our neighborhoods, in our communities, in Cuba, in Tijuana, and through our missionaries around the globe. God, would you be at work through simple acts of service that we'll do today? God, would you be at work? God, we give ourselves to you as an offering. Lord, would you take these lives and use them for your glory? We want to be consecrated to you, God. Lord, we love you and pray this in Jesus' name.